Hi, I'm Josh Payne, Extension Poultry Specialist with Oklahoma State University. During recent avian influenza outbreaks, I, along with several other composting subject matter experts from across the U.S., assisted commercial poultry operations with disease response. Most infected farms used composting as a means to manage mortalities and to inactivate the avian influenza virus. This video provides footage from the main avian influenza composting workshop and actual footage from the avian influenza outbreak. It is designed to provide an overview of the process and to help producers, poultry companies, the industry, and state and federal agencies prepare and respond to future outbreaks. In addition, we'll provide a series of brief videos covering topics such as siting considerations, carbon sourcing, temperature monitoring, turning compost windrows, and troubleshooting with interviews from top composting subject matter experts. A disease outbreak is devastating on any poultry farm, especially to the producer and the company, but it can be managed by following proven methods based on research and real-world experience.
The highly pathogenic avian influenza outbreak was the largest animal health emergency in U.S. history. Avian influenza viruses occur naturally in wild migratory birds, such as ducks, swans, and geese, and can infect domestic chickens, ducks, quail, pheasants, guinea fowl, turkeys, and other poultry. Unfortunately, when found in commercial poultry flocks, steps must be taken to keep the disease from devastating the industry. Infected birds either die from the disease or have been euthanized in an effort to control disease spread. However, dealing with mass poultry mortalities creates additional challenges for poultry producers. Proper carcass management is vital for controlling disease and managing nutrients. Improper disposal may cause odor nuisance or spread disease, and the resulting leachate or carcass fluids could negatively impact water sources. The avian influenza virus may still be present within the carcass, litter, feed, or eggs, and could be carried by insects, rodents, predators, and subsurface or above-ground water movement. It can also be spread through direct contact with other birds, leading to increased disease transmission risks. For these reasons, proper mortality management practices must be implemented immediately following a catastrophic event. And everyone involved must adhere to strict biosecurity measures in order to prevent disease transmission from human activity. Mass mortality composting was implemented on the majority of infected poultry operations during the recent avian influenza outbreaks. Mortality composting uses biological mechanisms to naturally degrade poultry carcasses. The compost material covering dead birds reduces odor in flies, while the heat created destroys the avian influenza virus, all in an environmentally sustainable and safe manner. By definition, composting is a controlled biological decomposition process that converts organic matter into a stable, humus-like product. Many homeowners are familiar with backyard composting using green and brown plant material. Composting poultry is characterized by microbial breakdown of a centralized nitrogen source, in this case, carcasses which are surrounded by carbon material. The process begins with naturally present microorganisms degrading soft tissue. Following soft tissue decomposition, thorough mixing of the carbon material, carcasses, and manure promotes a more ideal blend of carbon and nitrogen for optimum composting. For mass poultry mortalities, this entire process will take approximately 28 days. An initial farm assessment should be conducted in order to determine if on-site composting is suitable. Composting inside the poultry house in windrows is usually the best option. However, it requires adequate space for machinery and the piles. If space is not available, other on-site structures or outdoor compost sites can be considered. When conducting a farm assessment, note variables such as poultry house dimensions, litter depth, stored manure, mortality compost bins, total pounds of mortality, moisture content of litter, and water source. This information will help when determining the type and amount of equipment required, the amount of additional carbon required, and if additional water is needed. Equipment should be of adequate size and horsepower for the house type and material to be moved. For example, track loaders work better than skid loaders if maneuvering through wet manure. High-capacity buckets work well to move large amounts of material quickly. Other necessary supplies should include 36-inch long-stem thermometers, long-handled rakes, square-point shovels, personal protective equipment, hand pump sprayers, and disinfectant. A local supply of carbon material will also need to be found. The material selected should prevent flies from contacting the carcasses, serve as an insulating blanket, and allow air to flow out of the piles. It will also act as a biofilter between the carcasses and the environment. During an avian influenza outbreak, it is imperative to promptly construct compost windrows as soon as possible to reduce disease transmission risks, odors, flies, and scavengers. If composting inside the poultry house, prep the house by securing any loose cords, cables, hoses, or fans to keep machinery from becoming entangled. Skilled equipment operators are needed to run equipment carefully yet efficiently, especially inside a poultry house. Having experience operating equipment on poultry farms is preferred. Laborers will also be needed to scrape organic matter from sidewalls and perform other jobs. For in-house composting, birds and litter should be cleared to the floor surface for construction of the windrow base. For outdoor composting, an appropriate site must be identified based on soil type, distance to surface or groundwater, slope, and other considerations. To construct windrows, create a base layer approximately 10 to 15 inches thick and 12 to 15 feet wide of sufficiently porous and absorbent carbon material. Avoid driving over the base of the windrow as this causes compaction. Place carcasses, manure, and other infected organic material, such as eggs and feed, into the base layer forming the windrow core. The core should be constructed by adding material to either side of the windrow. Do not drive equipment on the side of the windrow either. Compacting the windrow sides reduces airflow into the pile and can result in poor pile performance. Upon completion of the windrow core, cap the mixture with 8 to 12 inches of suitable carbon material. The completed windrow should be approximately 6 to 8 feet high. Each windrow must be inspected and approved by appropriate state or federal officials. Compost windrows should be numbered and flagged at a minimum of 10 temperature monitoring locations, spaced equidistant along the length of each windrow. Following windrow construction, the first phase of composting will begin. Monitor daily temperatures using a long-stem thermometer. Both an 18-inch and a 36-inch temperature reading are collected at each flagged location and recorded on the daily temperature log. Compost that has met temperature criteria may be approved for turning after 14 days. The purpose of turning the windrow is to mix the core, base, and cap materials together. This process exposes the microbes to more oxygen in the pile and results in increased microbial activity, causing the temperature to rise and accelerate carcass degradation. When turning the windrow, cascade material from the loader to provide for proper mixing and aeration. If soft tissue is observed on the windrow surface, additional carbon material should be applied as a cap. Once windrows are turned, the second phase of composting begins. Daily temperatures are monitored and recorded. After 28 days, compost that has met temperature requirements may be approved for release. Once released, compost may be moved out of the houses for stockpiling or moved off-farm. This valuable byproduct can be land-applied as a soil amendment or fertilizer source, recycling nutrients and organic matter. Sometimes troubleshooting is required for piles that are not performing properly. For example, if excessive flies or odor are detected, piles should be capped with additional carbon material. If internal temperatures are not reaching the proper levels, then the mixture may be too dry or too wet. If too dry, add water to the pile. If too wet, add additional carbon to the pile and mix to absorb excess moisture. Windrow temperatures that drop too early may not be receiving enough oxygen. In this case, aerate the pile by mixing. Composting mass poultry mortalities is a procedure that can be implemented on most commercial poultry farms. This method requires guidance from a trained composting expert, proper equipment, experienced operators, and sufficient carbon, water, and space. During a disease outbreak, composting inside the poultry house is preferred, if possible, to minimize biosecurity risks and access by scavenging animals. Since carcasses are contained on farm, composting can be more biosecure compared to methods that transport carcasses off farm. The USDA Avian Influenza Mortality Composting Protocol requires a 28-day composting process. Hence, in-house poultry mortality composting may delay poultry house cleaning and disinfecting efforts, resulting in extended downtimes as compared to other disposal methods. Finally, proper composting can degrade poultry carcasses into a useful soil amendment and fertilizer.